We begin a new series of messages today from Philippians. My reading of Scripture will be portions of the first chapter in which Paul gives us the secret, the sure cure for discouragement. Hear the word of the Lord. I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine, making request for you with joy, for your fellowship in the gospel from this day until now, being confident in this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. And this I pray, that your love may abound still more and more in knowledge and discernment, that you may approve the things that are excellent, that you may be sincere and without offense until the day of Christ, being filled with the fruits of righteousness which are by Christ Jesus, to the glory and praise of God. But I want you to know, brethren, that the things that have happened to me have actually turned out for the furtherance of the gospel, so that it has become evident to the whole palace guard and to all the rest that my chains are in Christ. And most of the brethren in the Lord, having become more confident in my chains, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. May God add his blessing to this reading from his holy word and give us courage and strength to live our life to the fullest. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, thank you for the marvelous words you gave us in that lovely women's choir, that you indeed are at work in us. Help us to cooperate with what you're trying to do in us as a result of what's happening around us. We thank you for your strength and your power. You take us where we are, but you'll never leave us there. Praise and glory be to you, Lord, now and forever. Amen. There's a marvelous story about Thomas Carlyle. He was a great scholar and often would write all through the night. He discovered, however, much to his distress, that his neighbor had a rooster that would crow three times during every night, and always at the same time. And so as he'd be writing, he'd think, how soon will it happen? Is it about to happen? And so he petitioned all the rest of the neighbors to get rid of that rooster. And the neighbors said, oh, come on, Carlyle, that's not a difficulty. It only crows three times a night. And he said, oh, yes, but you should know the anguish I feel waiting for it to crow. Well, I think life is a lot like that. Past experience has indicated to us that sometimes life goes bump and we face difficulties that cause us discouragement. And very often we anticipate the discouragement and anticipate going through the tough times of life. I am convinced that underneath the surface of most people is a floating sense of discouragement. You know, I have a book that's about that big. It's a loosely folder. And in it are literally hundreds and hundreds of prayer requests that I receive from all of you and people across our nation. And that's my prayer book. And I keep it right next to my Bible. But I was amazed this past week as I thought about all of the requests and the expressions of need. How many people are feeling discouraged today? You know, it's been a tough time for America. Religious leaders defrocked, political leaders refusing to run, cherished, respected government officials exposed. that's not the only reason for our discouragement. The projects that we want to complete somehow never get done. The people we'd like to encourage and help sometimes refuse our best efforts. Very often we get downright disappointed in what people do and say. We'd love to change them and have them do what we want them to do, but we feel resistance. And very often we feel discouraged. Do you know that? But most of all, there's an inner kind of discouragement that we feel. It comes from being discouraged with ourselves. We don't perform the way we'd like to, don't accomplish the tasks that we set out to do. We get down on ourselves. And there's a direct interrelationship between being down on ourselves and being down on other people and life. I am convinced that discouragement, rather than being the proclivity, the private concern of a few depressed people, is really a common inner spiritual disease of most people. Remember the old song, 20th century blues, 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 20th century blues. What do you got to win and what do you got to lose? Perhaps we'd reword it, we seldom win and very often lose. And remember that marvelous song that was on Broadway for a time, Don't Bother Me, I Can't Cope. And the singers would go through all of the things that they didn't want anyone to bother them about. Don't bother me about the problems of society. Don't bother me about the problems of the family. Don't bother me about the problems of the church. I can't cope. Well, sometimes we feel that way, don't we? That we just can't cope with that deep inner sense of discouragement. Point one, discouragement is the illegitimate child of false expectations and deep disappointment. Now, Paul wrote to the Corinthians and also to the Philippians about this basic problem of discouragement. But the letter to the Philippians is most pointed. He deals with it directly and gives them a sense of joy in the midst of what they were feeling discouraged about there in that colony of Rome. The Lord is gracious and kind as he knows our needs and speaks to us where we are and helps us. And he spoke to those Philippian Christians in a very powerful way through the Apostle Paul. And what he did was to speak to them about the actual situations that were causing their discouragement. Criticism from Rome, difficulties of conflict with the other religions, internal strife within the church, and the conflict that they had with the Judaizers who followed the Apostle Paul's ministry wherever he went, telling people that they really needed to become Jews before they became Christians in order to have status in the kingdom of God. And so there was turbulence there in that church in Philippi. And the Apostle Paul wanted to give them courage. And how did he do it? To remind them that God had begun a great thing in them and that he would bring it to a conclusion. I believe that that's the only thing that offsets our feeling of discouragement. It's the realization that we are called and appointed and that we belong to the Lord, and what he has begun in us, he will bring to a conclusion. It's interesting that the Greek words in this verse, I believe that God, who has begun a good work in you, will bring it to completion until the day of Jesus Christ. The words indicate the beginning and the end of an ancient sacrifice. In other words, that which was begun will be fully completed. It's when the things around us discourage us that we draw within ourselves and ask ourselves the question, why was I born? What was I meant to accomplish? And what is the purpose for which I am alive? Paul calls the Christians there at Philippi back to their essential purpose, that is, to be formed in the image of Jesus Christ. What Christ began in them, he would complete. And what was that? Making them totally, intellectually, emotionally, volitionally, physically, in the image of Jesus Christ. He had begun a good work, and he would bring it to completion. Now that means that times of disappointment are really God's appointment. Point two. Once we begin to recognize that the difficulties that happen around us are for the growth that the Lord wants to have happen in us, we are liberated to take life in stride. Very often, when we get down on life because of what happens to us, if we surrender those things to the Lord, they become sources of growth rather than further separation from him. I've known that over and over again in my own life. And the great people I know have claimed this verse, that the Lord who began with them will bring to completion what he started. And the Lord uses all of the things that we go through, the disappointments, the difficulties, the hurts, those things that trouble us and disturb us, if we surrender them to him, all become encouragement of the growth of the good thing of Christ-likeness within us. I came across a marvelous statement by Dr. Billy Graham this past week. It was written about his experience of this verse, and it occurred at Forest Home. He had gone there prior to his first crusade. My understanding is that he spent a portion of the evening talking with Dr. Henrietta Mears and then went off into the woods to pray. And during that time, he said to God, I must either have something more than the partial faith with which I have endured life, or be sustained to be able to stand on a firm foundation. He opened his Bible, and here was this verse. God who has begun a good work in you will bring it to completion. And he said, I will not be frustrated any longer. That the Lord who gave me the gift of faith will provide the resources. His resources are limitless, and he will give me the power to stand. Now, since that day, crusade after crusade, all over the world, lives have been changed as a result of the realization that everything that happens around him is for what God wants to have happen in him. Isn't that exciting? I love to pray that prayer of Richard of Chichester. Oh, to love Christ more dearly, to know him more clearly, and to serve him more nearly. But let's press on. The Apostle Paul prayed for those Philippian Christians that they would be able to experience fully the truth of what happened in them. He said, I pray that your love will abound more and more. Now, abounding love, according to the Greek, is love that fills a container and then overflows. He prays that their experience in the midst of the difficulties of life that would discourage them would overflow, and that the truth that the Lord was trying to teach them would become personal experience truth. The word for truth here, that your love may abound more and more, and that you might have knowledge and discernment, means that as you feel loved, the things you go through give you an opportunity to come to grips with the truth that the Lord is trying to communicate. In other words, it isn't just an idea, it becomes an experience that builds fiber into our being. I heard from a young man in Georgia this past week. He's faced a lot of difficulties. His son has been ill. His wife has just been diagnosed with emotional exhaustion. He's wanted to move from the church in which he is presently a pastor and hasn't been able to get a call. And he called me on the phone and he said, Lloyd, I'm so discouraged, I don't know if I can go on. And I said, wonderful. And he said, what do you mean? I said, this, that the Lord is going to give you strength in each of these problems that you're facing, and as a result of it, you're going to be a better communicator of love and acceptance and forgiveness than you could have ever been without it. The Apostle Paul not only prayed that their love would abound and that they would experience what the Lord was trying to teach them, that it would become part of their character, but he also prayed that they might be sincere. And it's interesting that the word for sincere is without wax. It means a container that doesn't have wax in the cracks, that's authentic and real. And that they might be filled with the fruits of righteousness. What is that other than the fruit of the Spirit? Love, joy, peace, patience, and so on in the list. The Lord imbuilds his character into us in the difficult times that we endure. Now, the Apostle Paul didn't just state that as a conceptual truth. He gave a personal illustration from his own life. And that's what it takes to get a truth like that across. He said, I want you to know that the things that I've gone through have been for the purpose of the furtherance of the gospel. Now, do you know what he meant by that? Read on to the next verses. He describes the fact that his witness in prison was the source of the blessing of the guards who attended him, and that had given courage to the rest of the Christians in Rome. Now, you can just picture the situation. The Apostle Paul was in a private residence. He was a prisoner, but each day a guard was chained to him. Can you imagine what it might be like to be chained to the Apostle Paul? Well, they had to rotate the guards off of him because they all got converted. Isn't that wonderful? And they would take them out of Rome and send them some other place in the empire simply because in contact with him, they became Christians. I wonder how many people in contact with us, seeing us endure the difficulties of life with the power of Christ, making great strides in the midst of the most difficult situations, say, this Christianity is real. I don't believe that Jesus Christ gives us an exemption from reality. He gives us the power to live in the midst of the tough, gutsy issues of life. And that's the witness to the world. The world needs to hear, not razzmatazz, jazzy, trust it to Jesus and everything will be fine, because it isn't. When you trust it to Jesus, he helps you to go through it with his power. He builds in his character into you and gives you strength to witness to the people around you that this really works. Now, the Apostle Paul could say to the Philippians, look at my own life. The greatest advance for the gospel has come because I've been in prison. We've reached the vitals of the Roman Empire because the Lord, instead of allowing me to go on with my campaign of preaching, put me in prison. Now, that's the kind of faith that's virile and dynamic. That's the kind of faith that conquered the then known world, the kind of faith that makes for great Christians today. Yes, we face things that disappoint us, but the hour of our discouragement is the time of the release of the power of the Lord. If we spread it out before him and tell him, ask him to intervene and give us what we don't have ourselves, we will be able to endure. He'll never leave us nor forsake us. He'll be with us in the midst of it, that what he began in us will continue to grow, forming us into Christ-likeness, giving us strength and courage to grow in his image. It's life all the way up. Death is not an ending. Even in heaven, we continue to grow in Christ-likeness. I want to tell you, I know more of Jesus Christ today than I did 35 years ago when I gave my life to him. And I pray, God, I'm more like him now. But Praise God, I've only begun. I've barely scratched the surface. What about you? He wants to form you in his image. What he began, he will finish.